नमस्ते गुरु जी, जय गुरु जी महाराज, जय गुरु जी सत्संगत जी। सत्संगत जी, गुरु जी की आज्ञा से आज मैं पुनः आपकी सेवा में लाइट और डिविनिटी के कुछ पेजेस पढ़ूंगा। सत्संगत जी से प्रार्थना है कि मेरे पढ़ने में, मेरे सुनाने में अगर कोई मिस्टेक हो जाती है तो कृपया उसको नज़रअंदाज करते हुए उसको इग्नोर करें। इंसान गलती का पुतला है, गलतियां होती ही रहती हैं हम इंसानों से। तो गुरु जी सदैव, जैसे गुरु जी सदैव अपने गुरु संतों पर कृपा दृष्टि रखते हैं, वैसे ही आप सब से अनुरोध है कि कृपया उसको नज़रअंदाज करते हुए मुझे माफ़ कर देना। ओम नमः शिवाय, शिवजी सदा सहाय। ओम नमः शिवाय, गुरुजी सदा सहाय। ओम नमः शिवाय, शिवजी सदा सहाय। ओम नमः शिवाय, गुरुजी सदा सहाय। जय गुरुजी, शुक्राना गुरुजी। सत्संग जी, आज मैं लाइट और डिविनिटी के पेजेस 3-8 वो पढ़ूंगा। ये मेरा पाठन इंग्लिश भाषा में होगा, कृपया इसको सुने और ब्लेस्ड हों। जय गुरु जी, जय गुरु जी। द नेम ऑफ द टॉपिक ऑफ टुडेज नरेशन इज ए फिंगर that points to the moon. Imagine a towering mountain and a blemishless mirror fused into one. Imagine, if you can, that this mountain was made of incandescent light. And imagine that you were put before this mountain, your breath frozen in your throat. You looked at it. This is what your first darshan of Guruji would be like. When he wills this meeting to happen, he will penetrate into the core of your being. You will be denuded of all pretension. Your soul will be exposed to his gaze. And when you see yourself in him, when you glimpse your own lion-like divinity, you will truly be his disciple. Do not imagine that this meeting will not happen. Do not imagine that the Guru was made up of the body and has disappeared into the void. There are more darshans to come, 100,000 meetings to happen, and a majestic promise to be fulfilled between Guruji and his beloved disciples, the promise of love, that the Guru and the disciple be united in the clasp of eternity. We can keep our part of the promise by beginning to know ourselves. For the Sadguru, our Guruji is a mirror put up before our eyes that we can recognize ourselves. The Guru, as the word itself shows, removes the darkness, gu, of ignorance with the light, ru, of wisdom. In this nation's sacred tradition, the Guru is put on a pedestal even higher than that of the gods. He is seen as the sine qua non of the spiritual journey. He is the guide without whom the tentative first time climber and the stalled spiritual mountaineer are both lost. He is not only the path, not only the gate through which the seeker goes, but also the goal, the top of the mountain. He is the pole star in the journey from darkness to light, from ignorance to self-illumination, and all the scriptures of the world are but feeble commentaries on his nature. They are the fingers that point to the moon. So this is the topic, Sasangaji. They are the fingers that point to the moon. But when you have Guruji's darshan, the moon is right before you. Incandescent, if you choose to avert your gaze, not once, but again and again, the light of truth is too strong for you. The Guru's call is to the divine in you. His word are shabad, his hukam are fiat, is like the pebble that hits the lake. The entire lake shivers with the foam of its energy. And know that this energy is contagious, it is inescapable. Meeting the Guru or having his darshan is not like going for a social visit. It is like going to war knowing you are going to lose. It's like watching a fire burn the house of your ego down. It's a preparation to meet the highest. For the Sadguru robs man of his defenses. You cannot win over a Sadguru with words, alas. You cannot put up an appearance before him. He knows that the truth of your being. Accept that, hide nothing, don't play games with him. I will repeat it again, Sasangaji, for your information. He knows the truth of your being. Accept that, hide nothing, do not play games with him. When you come to him, it is not who you are that matters. It is not how confounded you are or how dark your deeds were or what promises of saintliness you are now making. What matters is whether you have said yes. That yes is the first most firm footstep on the spiritual journey. That yes brings innumerable gifts. That yes claps you to the Guru being with a force that even death cannot sunder. That yes brings the Guru's entire clemency, his grace to you. And that yes is perhaps the disciple's only task. The rest of the journey is a reaffirmation, footstep by footstep of the first step, that yes is the miracle. The rest are the miraculous details. An ancient prayer invokes the Guru as Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva. Guru Brahma, Guru Vishnu, Guru Gururur Devo Maheshwaraha, Gurur Sakshat Parabrahm Tasme Shri Guru Namaha. The holy trinity of gods for the Guru's being is limitless. He is not just the creator, means Brahma, the preserver Vishnu, the resurrector Maheshwara, or God's absolute Parabrahm. He is all creation himself. He is the thousand-eyed, thousand-limbed, thousand-mouthed God. He is the seed, the spore, the sap, and the tree of life. No one knows him. The wise are silent about his nature. But before the mirror of the Guru, the disciple sees and knows. Their seeing is the true darshan. All the rest are preliminaries that help lead him there. That knowing is truly touching the Guru's feet, for in that moment of illumination, the Guru is revealed. With footsteps of Shraddha, the disciple's journey towards the Guru is very strange. The disciple is blind, he is ignorant and cannot see the path. He cannot move ahead on his own. It is the Guru who leads him on. Thus, the Guru is not only the goal of the disciple, he is also the guide, the one to whom we are attached with the rope of faith on our mountain climb. Trust, thus, is the first prerequisite. If you cannot trust the Guru, you cannot be led. Hence, even though the Guru is fountainhead of spirituality, it has been advocated that would-be disciple check out the Guru before wholeheartedly accepting him. The Buddha advised as much. Just as gold is examined through burning, cutting and rubbing, so you should thoroughly test my teachings and accept them, but never out of reverence for me. Swami Vivekananda had such an attitude at first towards Sri Ramakrishna Paramhansa. Once the young disciple wanted to test his master's statement that he was unaffected by money. So he put a coin below Ramakrishna's pillow. The Guru could not sleep that night. Vivekananda's test had merely proven the spiritual armor of his Guru. Rid of doubt, the disciple can then humbly approach the Guru. His relationship with his spiritual guide rests on a firm footing. He can entrust himself to his guru in life as in death. Only after the strong foundation of trust or shraddha has been laid is the spiritual superstructure built. Man has to realize anew that he is a spiritual being made in his image. The guru prods the disciple to realize his divinity. A small story narrates how. Now, Sasangaji, I'm going to narrate a story. A cub had been separated from his tribe of lions. He began to live with sheep. In time, his behavior became exactly like theirs. He no longer roared, he bleated. A tiger saw him one day and was overcome by surprise. He caught hold of the still young cub and gave him a hard shake. "What's the matter with you?" the tiger roared. "Why do you behave like a sheep?" The terrified cub insisted that the tiger was mistaken. He was just a sheep. The tiger took the cub to a lake. The clear water reflected the cub's face. Immediately he realized his true nature. The guru's none too easy task is somewhat similar. He demolishes the apparatus on which our mistaken identity rests. We are his children, not creatures of mortal flesh and feverish blood. We are divine personages clothed in hide, not desired like animals. We are souls encased in bodies, not bodies with souls. Such a turmoil occurs when the disciple truly touches the guru's feet, that is, when his ego flakes away from his self. Only then does he receive the spiritual charge that wakes him up. The guru is a spiritual powerhouse, transmitting the current of spirituality into his disciples. At his graceful touch, the disciple awakens. Much preparatory work has to be done. However, we are laden with the permanent and karmic baggage of lifetimes. The power is generated by our karma, setting our minds not equipped with right attitudes can break our legs even as the journey begins. So the guru puts us in situations where we learn life lessons. Armed with the attitude, we keep our path through the many obstacles of life. The guru's grace is never more evident. Life comes up with challenges at this time to quicken the spiritual evolution of his child. The guru can take the disciple's karma upon himself, elevating its misery-causing effects. Sensing that we are about to set our foot on a karmic crevasse, he lifts us up and carries us on his own shoulders. What inconvenience can be heaped on such a guru? He can only be silent, loved, fully followed. Yet there are times when the disciple resents his guru. The guru leaves no physiological stones unturned to perfect his spiritual son, but the disciple's commitment wilts as the guru operates on his mental makeup. However much the disciple may finish from his guru's ego-hurting blows, the guru, bent on the disciple's perfection, carries his task through. At such weak moments, the disciple can't summon the will required to thwart his habits, but he need only realize that guru is taking pains on his behalf. The guru's sole interest, unlike the self-interest concealed in every human relationship, is a disciple. His only interest is to take the disciple Godward, whether he moves mountains or karmas out of the disciple's way to do this, whether he heals him of the disease or of mental plagues, that is his wish. These are only means to end up leading the disciple to God. The guru selflessly spends a huge amount of energy and time in fetching the disciple. The journey of the spiritual mountain is spirituality, as the Sadhguru transmits it, It's not a comforting philosophy. It is no cosmetic cream that can make our social faces and physiological mask look more beautiful for the moment. It is not a set of rituals and rites that we can fulfill to gratify ourselves or to flatter God. The spiritual train is a life-consuming affair. It is not a path that once lead can be walked out of. Once you are with the Guru, once you accept his stewardship, you must go where he leads you. The Guru is our only chance to become our divinity. He is the ladder that leads to God. He is the one who grants us self-realization. Everything in his hand is a device, from how he escapes the crowd to how he positions his relationship with us, but at all times, he is our Guru. No matter whether he is joking or blending an ear to the happening of the day, he is our Guru. And the last. And only through pleasing him or through attempting to please him shall the disciples succeed in getting to his chanting goal. Remember also that the Guru is not to be the story of each and every action of the great master. On a pilgrimage, the master stopped to take some alcohol from the hands of a peasant. The disciple closed on his heels, did so likewise, and probably with great enthusiasm. Some distance had stayed with the more than was coming out of the current foundry, unconcernedly, Sri Shikara asked for the liquid, cupped his hand and took a long sip. The disciple was disarmed. He could not follow his master now. The Guru's word had to be followed in letter and spirit, no doubt. Yet the disciple should not imagine himself to be Guru under any condition. It is much better to be continually engaged in lingually remembering the Guru. That with the Guru and the disciple are always linked in state. Spirituality in the hand of the Guru is a weapon to disarm our ego. Unless, I have repeated it again, spirituality in the hands of the Guru is a weapon to disarm our ego. Unless we are ready to be thus mercilessly exposed, do not ask a Guru or say you follow him. If you come to a Guru, rest assured that you will not receive continual ego messages. In fact, once you have fallen for a Guru, even slight indications of his power may disappear. The greatness of the Guru lies in that he takes us as we are. Part and all. He loves us in spite of our blemishes. He sets no preconditions for our journey. Nothing in his vision or alike. He sees no decision, he has none, like the sky, he encompasses all without touching them. He is an eternal witness. He is unblinking eye, steadfast on eternity. He is intimate with every flow through in the stream of his disciples' mind. The Guru is the highest, he is incomparable. His grandeur is above even than the Lord of Heaven. The sun, the moon, the stars are but encrustations of finite cosmic dust on his robe. The Holy Trinity, the countless gods and goddesses, the yogic powers are at his feet, ready to do his bidding. The Guru is God. The Guru is Shiva himself. In the Shiva Purana, Lord Shiva denies Lord Brahma's need to create beings bounded by mortality. He instead vows to descend on earth to remove such beings from the instant round of the birth and death. He came as Guruji in the dust of his feet. Ah, but this. May Guruji have mercy on you and I. May the rain of his mercy fall on our foolish heads. May we, through the very charge of his being, be laid at his feet. With this- this recitation of pages from जय गुरु जी, गुरु जी, धन धन।